in the process thereafter, I met, because I told you that I moved from here to Chipata because I was lonely. I'd lost my wife for hope, and then I went back to Chipata, and I'm sitting there. I have a little cousin and a girl, not a cousin, a granddaughter, and he kept saying to me, "Ambuya, who is cooking for you today?" And, I told her, "You come and cook." And she said, "No, today I'm busy and so on, but on Thursday or whatever the day was, I can come with my friend and we can prepare for you. If you buy this and that for us." I said, "I don't know how to buy those things." They gave her money. She went to buy. Her name is Annalena. She's now married. She's got her own children. She's married to a Mr. Msonda. And I remember this because it led to my marriage with my current wife. So she then comes with five girls, four girls and herself. I wasn't there. I had gone to a meeting of the Chamber of Commerce in Chipata. You know, once you're interested in organization, you always do something. So in Chipata, I joined the Chamber of Commerce. So that night, I was supposed to have dinner with them at about 7. And I come back at about 8, the food is not ready. The women are chatting. One of them was doing the hair of my current wife. So I told her, "But you said you were coming to cook for me. What is all this?" So I said, "No, I got carried away, but the food is going to be ready soon," and so on. And of course, the young ladies were all chatting me up. They knew that I had no wife. So chatting me up. And the only one who wasn't talking to me is the one whom I eventually married. But, of course, became curious. I was interested in her, too, because she was silent. And I wondered. So when we finished our dinner, I had a vehicle, an Isuzu, packed all the girls up and going there. And strategically, I made sure that this one who didn't talk to me,
dropped last.
I would talk to her last. So I took all of them, dropped them their various places, and, and I asked them, "Who are you? You were not talking." So I'm a teacher. I teach in Chiparamba, at a little school in Chiparamba. So, oh, by coincidence, I'm from Chiparamba. My parents originally come from Chiparamba. "Are you from Chiparamba?" I asked them. Said, no, I'm not from Chiparamba. I was born in Kitwe. My parents come from Isoka. But my brother works for the government here in Chipata. That's he who invited me to come and stay with him and put me through school. Interesting for me. Oh, young lady like this is teaching my people in Chiparamba, and she's from Isoka. So as I was dropping her off, she said, "Oh, goodbye. I will see you next time when I come." I said, "Why next time? Why can't we see you again?" He said, "No, I'm actually going to Jalimbana. I'm doing a
course in teaching.
Postgraduate, higher than primary school. I go every holiday. So I said, "When are you going?" And she said she was going on Friday, I think. I said to her, "Ah, but this is a coincidence. I was also going to."
Were you going to lose
that? I'm teaching young people to. But anyhow, we said we should tell stories about our life. So we traveled together, myself and my nephew and her. We took her up to Jalimbana. We got to become very good friends, started talking and so on. And so I started to know her program when she's back in Chipata. And then one thing led to the other. And she's my wife now and gave me these two, the twins.
So before you lose your thoughts, what struck you the most? I mean, you've redefined this thing we call age. And I mean, if you look at your wife, you look at the number of years. That is between you and her.
I mean,
what was very striking about her? What were you looking for in a woman?
I told you that when we were all seated together, everybody was busy chatting me up. And they were irritating me. The one who didn't talk to me, I don't know. I can't explain that. But I was impressed that she was very proud to be a teacher. She was very proud to teach in a rural area. She lived in a very remote place in the middle of Chipanamba at a little school and where she taught. Chipanamba is where the headquarters of the Chewa people in that area.
Mm.
So I was impressed by that, that here's a young Zambian
mm-hmm.
willing to serve our country, and a young Zambian who left the Copper Belt, the urban area, because most of us don't want to go to rural area,
not, yeah.
and followed her brother, who invited her to go to school,
mm-hmm.
and did well at school, and became a teacher, and agreed to teach in a rural area. All those things impressed me. I think, of course, besides her beauty, she's a good-looking young lady.
Of course.
Yes.
That had to count,
yes,
also.
And, then later on, of course, because she remained in Chipata, I used to come from Chipata
mm-hmm.
to hear, to board meetings and to check my rentals, collect my rentals from the properties that I had at the time and so on. And so I say to her, you are in Chiparamba
mm-hmm.
and you go to Chipata town to buy your provisions and so on.
Mm-hmm.
Let me introduce you to my mother
mm-hmm.
so that when you are coming through, my mother keeps the keys to my house,
yeah.
there's running water and mm-hmm. electricity and so on. You can stop here. I really genuinely
okay.
offered her that.
Because it wasn't a strategic move.
No, because I wasn't here. I was
okay.
there. And now when I look at it, it was a strategic move
uh-huh.
because my mother, which is a story I'm telling you, my mother got involved in this affair, of course. So she agreed. She said, tell your mother.
Mm.
So I took her to the house where my mother was. I said, oh, ni mwiyangu, agabopita, kia kutawo ni mwampasako kii wantaku. My mother, no, I'm going to wait. So
uh-huh.
I didn't think that she'd come.
Yeah.
A young lady living in Chiparamba in the middle of nowhere,
mm-hmm.
going to town. She would rather stay in town. If she has 2 days off, she would stay in town with her friends, go to nightclubs and so on. But by the time I went back after 1 month, she had been there twice.
Mm-hmm.
And she had spent 2 nights each time, the first time 2 nights, the other time, even 3 nights with my mother. And then my mother started
uh-huh.
talking to me about her.
She said, pay attention here.
Yeah, I said, ah, but in Mwana, my mother, Mwana Gazoja Parin. She told me. And she started encouraging me to marry her.
Yeah.
She said, you look lonely and so on. But I said to her, but she's young.
Yeah.
I have children who are older than her. I said, no, she's a good girl. And my mother,
mm-hmm.
which is the story that I want to tell you, my mother and my father were Jehovah's Witness, very staunch Jehovah's Witness.
Mm-hmm.
So before they can declare you to be good, you mm-hmm. must be a Jehovah's Witness. And it turned out that she was a Jehovah's Witness.
Oh, wow.
So during these days when they're together,
mm-hmm.
they would spend a lot of time talking about the Bible and what they should do for the people and so on. So that impressed my mother, and she wanted very much for me to have a Jehovah's Witness as well. So mm-hmm. when I came back and asked her, she said, oh, I forgot, I didn't even ask her whether she came,
mm-hmm.
because it was not my intention to. So my mother said, oh, am I well?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and we have spent a lot of time together. So Namaiva, we don't go. So I said, how do you know?
Yeah.
She is a Jehovah's Witness. She's a very honest girl.
Yeah.
She's very nice. Where can you find a young lady of her age going to, instead of staying in town with her friends and going to nightclubs and going to drink, she comes and stays here with me and all that. She's a nice girl. Think of it.
Mm.
That's how. So I said, even my mother approves.
Mm-hmm.
So, I can
so
as well.
Who am I to say no? The rest is history.
It's one of the incidences which I'm sure you wanted to know.
Of course. I was going to ask that, but it's like you read my mind.
Yes.